You're listening to WKCR FM New York and WKCR HD1. What we just heard was Vampiro Theon. And now we are going to get into this interview that Joe has so graciously been promoting the past couple hours on the show with Caroline Shaw. First, I just wanted to play one of her pieces. Caroline Shaw, if you don't know, is a new classical composer, vocalist, violinist, kind of a jack of all trades. And I wanted to play just one of her vocal pieces performed with the Ataka String Quartet, just to kind of give you a sense of her style as a composer before we actually hear from her. And so coming up next is And So, again with the Ataka Quartet with Caroline Shaw. Stay tuned.
What a song by any other name sound as sweet and true. Would all the reds be just the same, or violets blue. If you were gone, would words still flow, and would they rhyme with you? If you were gone, would I still know how to love and how to grow? Will the memory suppose, is all we were and all we'll be. And so the saying, so it goes, depends a lot on if a rose is a rose, is a rose, is a rose, is a rose, is a rose. Is a rose the thing sublime? And so we stay on borrowed
time. What you just heard was And So by Caroline Shaw, performed by Caroline Shaw with the Ataka Quartet. And if you hadn't heard already, we are going to be featuring Caroline Shaw, composer, violinist, vocalist, on the next 2 hours of Afternoon New Music here on WKCR. Just a couple days ago, I had the opportunity to interview Caroline Shaw over the phone. She is one of my personal favorite new music composers working today, and I was just really thrilled to be able to talk to her about music and her approach to composition and performing, and I'm really excited to share what she had to say with you guys. And so we are going to get right into it. Just for a little bit of context, before I play a clip from this interview, Caroline Shaw recently had an album come out called Orange, performed by the same people that we just heard on that last piece, the Ataka Quartet. It's an album of string quartets, and it just won a Grammy just on Sunday night for Best Chamber Performance. It's really a fantastic record. Very harmonically rich, often complex, but what I love about Caroline's music is that it also taps into something very visceral and of the body rather than the mind. It does both, which is something I really admire. And so in this clip, Caroline Shaw talks a little bit about what the string quartet means to her as a form, because it is very important form for her as a composer. It's kind of where her roots are, as you might say. And so yeah, we're gonna get right into it. Again, coming up, an interview with Caroline Shaw, composer, vocalist, violinist, here on WKCR FM New York and WKCR HD1. I'm Patrick Simpson. Stay tuned. It's an album of compositions for string quartet, of course. And the string quartet as a form seems to be really important to you. Mm-hmm. As I understand, it's kind of how you started growing up. You played in string quartets, and I think I heard that on an interview that the first piece that you ever composed was a string quartet in like the style of Mozart. Is that right?
I mean, I think I was just it was not a very good piece, but I had just learned about Mozart string quartets at that time, and I thought, oh, this is interesting. I would like to make something like that. So I wrote something down, figured out how to write it down in my big, fat, bubbly music note letters. and it was kind of the beginning of a of a wonderful journey.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I just wanted to ask you, what is it about the string quartet that makes you want to keep going back to it? It's this, you know, very, very old form in classical music, and you're finding all of these new sounds that you can get out of it. And I'm just curious about, like, what about that form in particular do you find so compelling?
Sure. It's, I mean, I love the string quartet, not just for the, you know, the sounds and the instruments, which, you know, there's so many other composers living right now and in the last 50 years who have definitely been diving into, you know, what the string quartet can do and how do you make new combinations of sounds. For me, I'm actually almost more interested in the people and the social form of it and the communication that goes on between those four people when playing in a string quartet. So I've played myself, I've played a lot of, you know, Beethoven, Mozart, Haydn, a lot of the standard repertoire. And I just love playing with other people. I love playing with my friends and looking across and, like, you know, you ride on someone else's sound for a moment and then you go away, or you're supporting them at one moment and then you're leading them the next. So it feels kind of like a game. It feels like, I don't know, I think of soccer or basketball. I don't play basketball very much, but I watch it a lot, and soccer I've played, where you're kind of, there's this like tension between players that you, like a sort of tension and release that happens in any game. And chamber music feels very much like that. It feels like a game, like a really fun game to me. So mm-hmm. when I was writing those pieces, it was kind of thinking about, yes, harmony is super important to me. It's the first thing I start with. Melodic cells, elements of the music that you recognize and that come back and that you change and twist around, but also trying to make music that would be enjoyable to play together. And I'm really lucky to get to work with, you know, groups like Ataka and many other string quartets. But I also love, I mean, the string quartet form, it really goes back to 15th century and 16th century, when these old viol consorts in especially in Italy and France were starting up. So you had these kind of music written for people to play together in their home. And thinking about resonance and the beauty of certain chords and just the beauty of sound that they were discovering in the 16th century mm-hmm. and how now, many centuries later, it's still beautiful and still enjoyable to make those chords together. I love it.
And again, that was Caroline Shaw, from an interview that I did a couple days ago. And now we are going to hear one of her string quartets from her album Orange. This is Valencia, performed by the Ataka Quartet. And coming up after this, we are going to hear more from Caroline. She's going to talk a little bit more about her album Orange, and also quite a lot about gardening, actually. So stay tuned.
Thank you.
That was Valencia by Caroline Shaw, performed by the Ataka Quartet. And that is the second track off of Caroline Shaw's new album, Orange, which, if you just tuned in, just won the Grammy for Best Chamber Music Performance. And I had the opportunity to interview Caroline Shaw, and we're going to continue with that interview now. She's going to talk a little bit about her ideas concerning gardening. In the liner notes to Orange, for a little bit of context, she uses a metaphor of a garden. She imagines the world of Orange as being like a garden that she and the Ataka Quartet tend to. And I just want to read verbatim what she has to say here. Just to give you an idea of what she's talking about. Hints of past year's growth remain in the soil, and so the new growth has been partially shaped by the old. The colors are vivid and familiar, and the shapes of the leaves follow a pattern that you seem to know until you don't. And Caroline is going to talk a little bit more about what she was thinking when she was writing those liner notes, and a little bit about her experience studying landscape architecture in Europe. And then after that, we're going to hear more of her music and then more of this interview. So stay tuned. This is WKCR FM New York and WKCR HD1. And I can't help but think that this is related to how you spent a year in Europe studying landscape architecture, if I'm correct.
Yeah.
Yeah. Can you like talk a little bit more about that experience, or if that's kind of what you were thinking about when you were describing it in that way?
You know, I kind of go back to the metaphor of the garden, or to the metaphors that the garden kind of releases into the world a lot. I think partially because of that interest that I had back in college and the year after college. So I spent a year on a Watson Fellowship, which means you basically have a very small amount of money to go and do a project out in the world, not in your home country. And you're independent the whole time. And my interest was in landscape architecture and basically how people think about design and space and nature throughout kind of, I don't know, in Western aesthetics. But it, then later on in my life, it's sort of become much more about what is a garden, like not just what's the Versailles garden, what are the big fancy gardens, the big formal ones, but how does one as a person in the world cultivate one's own personal garden? So I had a little fire escape garden, and it's all about understanding the soil and how does it work and what's the health of the soil and what does each kind of plant need, and what's also the history of that soil, like what has decomposed in there before, what are the what's the kind of chemical makeup of that soil. And it's fun to think about you know, ensembles and groups of people and maybe a certain kind of music as fertile soil that you can dig around in and plant something new in. So the string quartet, there's a huge history of the string quartet the last 400 years roughly, and there's so much music that was written 400 years ago that is in some way a part of the players playing today. They may play something from, you know, the 21st century with informed by the way that they think about something from the mid 1700s. So it just feels like there's this rich garden. And then I feel like when I'm making music, I'm writing something that grows and is hopefully nourishing or enjoyable. It's wonderful to think about music as nourishment. So I guess that's kind of part of it. But another meaning for the album, the title Orange, is, and the cover of it is just a beautiful photograph of an orange that the cellist Andrew Yee kind of designed with a photographer named R.T. Mueller. But it's just looking at this simple object that you see every day in the grocery store, but appreciating its beauty and complexity and the beauty of everyday things. And that's also kind of part of it. So some of the music that I wrote is, some of it's more complex, sometimes it's very simple, but maybe sometimes it's just about appreciating the, or just loving the sound of a simple chord.
Can you talk a little bit more about your that year that with the fellowship that you spent in Europe doing that? You've mentioned in interviews that it was like a particularly important time for you in your creative development, and that you find yourself returning to things that you thought about at that time in your work since then. Mm-hmm. Can you talk a little bit more about that?
Yeah. I think one of the big things that I thought about with that Watson Fellowship and the project with the gardens is the way that some garden designers want to control nature and kind of create symmetry and very clear lines, so that you see this kind of their kind of ideal design of nature, so that the, you know, everything lines up, those are more the French formal gardens versus the English landscape gardens, where they're trying to construct the illusion of a completely untouched natural landscape. So you're essentially letting, you want to create this feeling that you are in the wildness of nature, although in reality that garden is completely constructed and everything is designed. Central Park is a lot like that, where every tree and hill was planted and designed, but it's designed to feel like the wildness of nature. And I think that's really interesting when I write music, is sometimes I want, you know, things to be absolutely clear and line up and be absolutely sort of crisp and perfect. There's a piece for Ritornello that kind of opens that way, where it's all the chords are tightly wound. And then in the middle of Ritornello, there's a place where it kind of goes crazy and you allow the players to kind of do what they want. It's a little bit more improv in the middle of it. And I think a lot in music about trying to write a certain freedom in the music. So you almost create an environment where a musician can walk around and feel comfortable, feel free to express themselves, and yet know kind of where the pathways and where to go and how to get home. But it's not a, you know, sort of strict assignment or a perfectly prescribed route. Yeah.
Right.
I don't know if I would stand by that entirely. I still write music that's pretty prescribed, but with the idea that you don't necessarily need to play, you know, articulate each moment, each note a particular way. There's some element of choice or personal expression in it.
And again, if you just tuned in, that was composer, violinist, vocalist Caroline Shaw talking a little bit about why she compared her album Orange to A Garden in the liner notes. And now we are going to hear that piece that she was talking about there, Ritornello. And I hope you all can hear what she was talking about in comparing it to how she thinks about landscape architecture, because I think the metaphor is apt. But even if you don't, the music itself is just incredibly beautiful. So I hope you all enjoy. Again, this is WKCR FM New York and WKCR HD1. I'm Patrick Simpson. Stay tuned. You're listening to WKCR-FM New York and WKCR-HD1. What we just heard was Ritornello, composed by Caroline Shaw and performed by the Attacca Quartet on Caroline Shaw's latest album titled Orange, which again just recently won the Grammy for Best Chamber Performance. And if you just tuned in during that piece or just tuning in now, I had the opportunity to interview Caroline Shaw, who is not only a composer but also a violinist and a vocalist and identifies primarily as a musician, just a maker of music in general. We are going to continue with that interview now. Caroline is going to talk a little bit about the inspiration behind another one of the pieces on this album called Entr'acte. This is one of her more popular pieces. It is the first track on the album, and it was inspired by a moment in one of Haydn's string quartets, and you're going to hear Caroline talk a little bit about that. And then we're going to get to hear Entr'acte, and after that, hear a little bit more of my interview with her. So again, this is WKCR-FM New York and WKCR-HD1. You're listening to Afternoon New Music. I'm Patrick Simpson. Coming up next, Caroline Shaw. Stay tuned. I want to talk about the first piece that's on Orange, Entr'acte.
Yep.
It's a really beautiful piece. And as I understand it, it was inspired by a particularly lovely transition in one of Haydn's string quartets. Can you talk a little bit about like that moment, what it is, and what you've found interesting about it?
Sure. There was a concert that I attended in Richardson Hall at Princeton. It was the Brentano String Quartet. They're at Yale now, but they were playing a Haydn String Quartet. I think it was Opus 77, number 1 or 2. And Haydn quartets are made up usually of 4 movements. Outer movements are fast, there's a slow movement in the middle, and then there's this minuet and trio, which I always find to be the most annoying movement. It's like sort of dippy, and you're like, okay, it's just it feels like the throwaway. But in this particular one, when they shifted from the minuet to the trio, which is sort of the middle section, it went into a flat key. I want to say it was probably D flat major. That's just such a magical key anyway. Mm-hmm. But the way that they kind of played that shift, that harmonic shift, they shifted their sound, just shifted the color. You felt like they had shifted the color and the temperature of the room in some way, just by the way that they held that space before it, and then the way that they played the first note. And I just remember that feeling of there's something like those sudden shifts. Sometimes they're non sequiturs. It was kind of a non sequitur shift. There's no subtle transition between the minuet and the trio, just suddenly went into another world, and how beautiful that is. And like how you remember in like Wizard of Oz when she opens the door and suddenly it's Technicolor, that feeling, or in Alice in Wonderland where you go into another world. And I kind of wanted to make a piece that allows that to happen several different times, and is also kind of uses the old repeat structure of a, you know, 18th century minuet, almost as a like, tongue-in-cheek reference to it. And these are things that I feel like you're kind of not allowed to do in contemporary music. A, you don't have repeat signs ever. And also, we're taught never to just introduce new material that has no relation to the thing before it. Everything must be related. Mm. But, well, there's actually, I enjoy a lot of music, especially in hip-hop. I think Kanye really works this way of like the power of the total non-sequitur. But you make your own relationship between those two things that are adjacent. So that was the idea of the piece. Yeah, that's Entr'acte. But yeah. Also it started with harmony and finding certain chords that I respond to in my gut, and then arranging them in a way that I respond to with my brain. And that's sort of how I tend to write music.
And again, that was Caroline Shaw. And now we are going to hear Entr'acte, again performed by the Ataka Quartet here on WKCR.
Thank you.
And that was Entr'acte, composed by Caroline Shaw and performed by the Ataka Quartet on Caroline Shaw's latest album, Orange. You're listening to WKCR FM New York and WKCR HD1. And if you just tuned in the last 10 minutes or so, The past hour or so, I've been featuring works by Caroline Shaw because I recently had the opportunity to interview her, and I've been playing clips from that interview this show, and we are going to continue with that now. One of the things, just for a little bit of context, one of the things that I really admire about Caroline Shaw is that she doesn't really see a boundary between the classical world and the world of mainstream music. She has crossed over from the classical world into hip-hop and pop very, very easily. And here she is going to talk a little bit about how she collaborated with none other than Kanye West on a few of his songs. I believe that she worked on a few songs off of The Life of Pablo. And she also did a remix of the track Say You Will, which is the first track off of Kanye's 808s and Heartbreak. And I thought this was a pretty interesting and uncommon thing for classical, new classical, modern classical composers to do. And so I really admire it. She's going to talk a little bit more about working with Kanye in this clip, and then we are going to hear her remix of that Kanye track, Say You Will, after that, and then after that, a little bit more of the interview. So without further ado, here's the clip. Again, you're listening to WKCR-FM New York and WKCR-HD1. I'm Patrick Simpson on Afternoon New Music. Stay tuned. It's funny you bring up Kanye. I wasn't going to ask this, but since you brought it up, what was that like collaborating with him?
Super interesting. I'm not really working with him right now. We had a disagree with some of his political leanings, but my experience, at least in 2015, 16. And a little bit in Wyoming in 2018. He works in such a different way from, I always say working with Kanye is the opposite of working with an orchestra because things change so quickly and he's very open to new sounds. And also, I think it was the first time I saw someone really respond to a sound. Like, do I like the sound or not? Is it dope or not? Does it hit me or not? And that's also not something that I think we talk about in contemporary classical music, because just sort of your initial impression of a sound. Although there are people certainly working with timbre, I think that definitely do work in that way of sort of noticing what your gut reaction is to a particular sonority. But I also like that he has many people in the room who are all really good at what they do, but everyone's pretty humble and I'm very shy. So when I'm in the room, I don't say very much, but he has to sort of coax it out of me and turn to me and say, Caroline, what do you think? So I want you to say what you think. And eventually I'll say something, but I usually keep to myself. And I also like, I'll get a bit of a track and then go home and take 24 hours to turn it into something new, and then I'll sort of come out the other side with this new version, and then we start to work from there. But it's interesting.
I really like what you said about the track "Say You Will." You did a remix of it, but you said what you really liked about that track is that the last 2 minutes nothing happens. Like, it's just this space of nothingness. Yeah. Can you talk a little bit more about that?
In the original track Say You Will from the album 808s and Heartbreak, I mean, it's so out the way that it ends. Nothing happens. There's just that sort of drum machine beat and a little bit of like a kind of synth choir holding down the harmony beneath, but nothing happens for like a solid 2 minutes. And there's such, as you said, like you know, there's such emptiness in there, but it's also such a non-pop move. It's such a like weird experimental thing to do. And then what I kind of decided, like he asked me to, you know, try anything I wanted to with any of those tracks, and I listened for a while, and that was the song that spoke to me. And that, what if you, there's a lot of devastation in this song, but it's not kind of at the foreground. It's very kind of like simmering underneath. And what I wanted to do is then, you know, what if in the first, you know, 15 seconds of the song, you go from something very simple and very like quietly shy and devastating to like everything is thrown at you. So I created that kind of weird, like vocal fry, weird gliss into epic choir that happens, I don't know, 8 bars in or so. I can't remember now. But I like listening to like, what's the essence of a song, or like, that's kind of how I work with them. Like if you get some bit, like what's, all right, what could this be about? Or what is it about? Or what's a way to amplify the thing that is already there? And that song was just so rich.
Yeah, yeah.
And yet so simple. And that's the beauty of it. I think I really like my remix, but I also love how weird and spare the original is. I think it's incredibly beautiful.
And again, that was composer Caroline Shaw. And now we're going to hear that remix of that track that she was talking about there. Coming up next is Say You Will by Kanye West, featuring Caroline Shaw, here on WKCR FM New York and WKCR HD1.
Why would she make calls out the blue? Now I'm awake, sleeping soon. Hey, 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 don't say you will, unless you will. Hey, 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 don't say you will, then play. Touch your soul. Take off your cool, then lose control. This song will really come true. I admit I still fantasize about you. Hey!
and you're listening to WKCR-FM New York and WKCR-HD1. That was Say You Will by Kanye West, remixed by Caroline Shaw. And if you're just tuning in, I got the opportunity to interview Caroline Shaw, and we're going to continue with that interview now. This is the last clip that I'm going to play here on Afternoon New Music, and then we are going to hear her Partita for Eight Voices, which won her the Pulitzer Prize back in 2013. She, at the time, was the youngest recipient for the Pulitzer Prize in music ever, and now that title goes to Kendrick Lamar, actually, but she is still the second youngest. So we are going to continue with this interview. For a little bit of context, I asked Caroline here in a bit of a rambling sort of way what she thinks about in terms of collaboration versus finding your own unique compositional voice. So balancing the social aspects of music and learning from others and copying others while still making what you make your own, and how she thinks about that process. So without further ado, here is Caroline Shaw on WKCR-FM New York and WKCR-HD1. Stay tuned. You're drawing all of these different things in together, like how the movements are named after Baroque dances, or you're bringing in extended vocal techniques like tube and throat singing, or like text from Saul LeWitt. And you're kind of borrowing all these things. And it's a piece that's written for your ensemble, Roomful of Teeth specifically. So it's kind of a piece mm-hmm. that I see as growing directly out of collaboration with others. Mm-hmm. But at the same time, you've said that that piece is like the most you that you've ever put into like a piece of music before. And I'm just interested in that like balance between having your own compositional voice while also working with other people and these social aspects of music that you've talked about, how much you love them, and it seems like a big part of your career.
Yeah, I think, I think when I said that it was the most me I've ever put into a piece of music, it was also like one of the first pieces of music I ever wrote. So I put anything I knew into it. But I still feel like that. It was very, I made the different movements of Partita over 3 summers that we were working at Mass Mocha, in North Adams, Massachusetts, with Roomful of Teeth, which I'm a singer in. I should clarify it. I didn't start the group. It's not my group, but I'm very much a part of it.
Right.
And, it was great to be able to kind of make bits of music, at night, and then bring them in the day, and just see how they sound, how they feel, how people respond to them. And like, assuming it's like, oh yeah, that's really cool. It's like, all right, that's a signal. Let me kind of keep working with this. Or something doesn't feel comfortable, then I figure out a way to do it that's healthy. The idea of sort of bringing other styles or text in was very much, it was just kind of a product of the feeling in the room that summer, and the things that we were, as singers, were talking about and working with, and the people that we were meeting, and kind of without thinking about the logistics of all of it, I just made what felt right. And then there are bits of text, like there's a one line that's my own, which is "Find a Way Back Home," is a line of T.S. Eliot from Burt Norton, which is "The detail of the pattern is movement," which is a phrase that you've used in several pieces, and the Saul LeWitt was right there. As for collaboration, I do love it. It's also can be incredibly, it can be difficult if not kind of set up in the right way where you're, you know, it's wonderful when you trust each other. It's difficult when you don't know each other very well, but I'm really lucky to get to work often with players or singers that I trust and know and like, and that's some of the best music making. And I think that, you know, as music creators, whether you call it a composer or a musician or songwriter or producer, I mean, they're all kind of different words for this, for different aspects of music creation. I think you can't help but make music that's a part of the world that you live in. And I've never really, I've certainly played and performed a lot of music that is meant to sort of abstract music far from the familiar. And that's also a really wonderful way to think about music and sound. But I think the music that excites me is stuff that plays with familiarity in a way that sort of takes something that you feel like you know for a moment, and then it turns it around into something that you don't know or that you weren't expecting, or it sort of opens a door that you didn't know was there. Kind of like a dream state, you know, when you dream and then you dream about a room that's very familiar. It's like your kitchen, but then something about it turns, or you meet a person that's familiar and then they turn into something else. I always find that really fun. So I think maybe that's part of why a lot of different elements come into my music, because that's the material that's around.
And again, that was Caroline Shaw talking a little bit about how she approaches creativity and collaboration, especially in relation to the Partita for Eight Voices, which, as I said before that clip, won Caroline Shaw the Pulitzer Prize for Music back in 2013. And the Partita is one of my favorite pieces of Caroline's, probably my favorite, certainly the first piece that I ever heard from her, and her most popular. It is stunningly beautiful. And like I said, when I asked her that question, and like she said, you can hear that it is totally honest. It is an honest expression of who Caroline is as both a composer and a performer and just as a person. I think it's just a gorgeous piece of music. I really hope that you guys enjoy it. And this is the last thing that we are going to hear on Afternoon New Music this afternoon. And so, without further ado, coming up next is Caroline Shaw's Partita for Eight Voices, performed by Roomful of Teeth, of which she is a member. This is a live performance from Music on Main. And I'm only playing this live performance because, personally, in my opinion, I like the quality better than the studio recording they put out there. But the studio recording is also worth checking out. So coming up next, Partita for Eight Voices here on WKCR-FM New York and WKCR-HD1. I'm Patrick Simpson. Stay tuned.
To the side.
To the side.
To the side.
And around through the middle.
To the side.
To the side.
To the side.
And around through the middle.
To the side.
To the side.
To the side.
To the side.
And around and around
and around and around
and around.
To the side. 2, 3, 4,
and across. 5, 6, 7, 8.
Through the midpoint.
Of the line drawn from
left side.
And around and around
and around
and around
and around
and around and around
and around
and around and around.
Right corner.
The detail of the pattern is movement.
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 The detail of the pattern is
movement.
The detail of the pattern is
movement.
The detail of the pattern is movement.
The detail of the pattern is movement.
The detail of the pattern is movement.
The detail of the pattern is movement.
4, 5, 6, 7, 8.
The detail of the pattern is movement.
The detail of the pattern is movement.
The detail of the pattern.
3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8.
The detail of the pattern is movement.
The detail of the pattern is movement.
Hmm.
It's located at the 45th place.